He talked about how he has plans to revive the coal sector production, Coal India production. Again, very few people believed him back then, but I think that has also turned out to be the case and it's on an improving path. So let's hear what Mr. Piyush Goyal has to say this time. So over to Mr. Goyal.
Intimidating if you threaten me with coming out with something which has to turn out true. But I'm very, very concerned, because if that's the only two predictions that I've made in the last 2 years, then I've not been very effective. I thought I said much more than that.
At the conference.
Come true. But always delight to meet with colleagues from the investment field. CLSA, of course, has over the years brought different perspectives on the table. Of course, many of them I don't agree with very often, including some recent report I read 1 or 2 days back on the newspaper. There's some small paper clipping. Was it some report that CLSA has come out with in the last 3-4 days? There is some report that I read which I thought was very, very stupid. But irrespective, always a pleasure to interact with CLSA on these conferences. Somebody here has cracked it, or haven't you? No. So maybe, I hope I'm not mixing you up with some other reports, because that's another too many reports you read and then you get all muddy-duddy at the end of the day. But yes, it's been a privilege coming to your conference for the quality that I find in the deliberations here and in the questions that are often raised. 2013, of course, I came as an opposition member of parliament and was probably just before the heat of the election. 2014, I was still quite a rookie. I'd just taken an active role in government a few months before I came here. But I can assure you that whatever I may say today, or whatever was said and done in the last 2 years, comes with conviction. Whatever this government is doing, whatever Prime Minister Modi has set out to do, he works with a passion that, to my mind, India has never seen before. He is committed to changing the destiny of India. And in everything that he says and does, while each one of us can pick up the threads that we are interested in, somebody may be interested in energy, somebody may be interested in climate change, somebody may be interested in real estate, and I'm sure CLSA has interests spanning all sectors of the economy. And there may be people here in the room who would look at different aspects, analysts who are looking at the macro, people who are looking at what's happening on the ground, concerns for climate change and whatnot. But I can assure you the one distinguishing feature of this government and the leadership of Prime Minister Modi is the holistic vision to impact people's lives. The organic entity that he's trying to create, both in his government and within the ecosystem in India, where government has a role to play, people have a role to play, governments at all levels, from center down to the local government, investors of all hues and cries, domestic and international, business has its own role to play, NGOs have a role to play. It's a organic entity that is trying to create an ecosystem where we all learn and support each other. We learn from you, we take ideas back from engagements such as today's, we try to implement things, we go back to stakeholders. And in that sense, it's been a government which has been responsive to what we get from interactions such as today. In fact, I've been on record many times to say that in the last 18 months, I would judge big and small, I would have had about 2,500, 3,000 interactions. in the 500, 600 days gone by. Some would be mid-level like this, some would could even be a 50,000 people public program, and it could be a 5 people, 10 people small conference. Every one of those engagements has been a learning experience. In every one of those, there's some thread you pick up which gives you some idea, some thought process which gets ignited. And some of them may fall by the wayside as you go along, but many of them kind of seed a new thought, seed a new concept. And in that sense, my own interactions at CLSA have been very, very both engaging and informative for me. So I thank you for this opportunity. Well, the fact that BJP would get an absolute majority is what I had said, not just a big number. I had said here that we'll get an absolute majority. And it came out of a conviction that what we are offering to the people of India and the leadership that was being proposed to lead the party in government was clearly one with an established track record, one whose heart and soul was in the development of India, and one who would bring about change, which was unparalleled. And we were therefore very confident that the people of India will elect us and bring us into government. It was an election where we were able to ride many other considerations. Very often Indian elections have been influenced by issues which went beyond good governance and development and progress and economy. But we were very confident that at that stage, the offering was so powerful, the message was so strong, that Prime Minister Modi would, or at that time Chief Minister Modi, would be the alternative which the people of India would accept. Last year I had come to you after my first few lessons in the power and energy sector. And if I remember, I'm not very clear what was the tenor of my talk that day, but it would largely have focused on a root cause analysis that had determined what my priorities as a minister should be. So the first few months, the focus was on learning what had gone wrong, understanding the pain points of the sector, doing a root cause analysis to see what the issues that bothered this sector most were, and prioritizing my work. And I'm sure in that context, I must have mentioned about coal. And I don't know whether I said it here, but very logically, if somebody were to study the power sector as I inherited it on 27th of May 2014, amongst the various areas under me, power generation was badly affected, not because of capacity constraint, but because of fuel constraint, both coal and gas. Wherever there was sufficient availability of power, it was badly affected in terms of ability to transmit to various parts of India, because the transmission infrastructure, which takes years to roll out, had not been planned sufficiently in advance. And then at the last mile, of course, there were connectivity issues. At that point of time, the census 2011 had highlighted that nearly 250 million people in the country, 67 years after independence, were still deprived of a basic amenity like electricity. And all in all, it was a sector which I believe was one of the biggest challenges that that most analysts, that most readers of the Indian economy were waiting to, or watching with great interest to see what would happen going forward. Of course, just before I came here, possibly we had also had the cancellation of 204 coal mines. maybe a month or two before I must have come here. You usually have it in November, right? So that was 24th of September when 204 coal mines allotted to different companies and different sectors, predominantly power, but also other sectors, had been cancelled. So I think it was in that backdrop that I would have come and addressed all of you over here. A lot of water has flown down the bridge in the last 1 year. The priorities that were set a year ago in terms of making sure there's adequate availability of fuel, both on coal and gas, the priority to expedite completion of transmission projects, many of which were languishing for years for different bottlenecks, sometimes land acquisition, right of way, environmental concerns, and what not have you. The fact that India was never conscious of energy conservation and energy efficiency until a year ago, the way it is today. And finally, the fact that distribution companies, DISCOMs, were possibly at the nadir, every year adding another $10 to $12 billion of loss and having an accumulated loss of nearly $60-70 billion. The last mile connectivity or ability to distribute power was truly suspect. So that was the picture about a year ago, which I think in the last 1 year has dramatically changed. From banner headlines in newspapers screaming that power plants are all going to shut down and India is going to face a huge power crisis, there's coal barely for 1 day and 4 days and 3 days in the power plants. We have come to a situation where today I have surplus coal. I, as in the country today, has surplus coal on the one hand. We have surplus power on the other hand. Large amounts of transmission lines, which were languishing for years, have got completed in the last 18 months. A number of new projects have been initiated, particularly on the transmission side, and this time around, not following demand, but anticipating demand going forward as far ahead as 10, 15, and 20 years. Renewable energy has seen a thrust which was never before witnessed. And if I may venture to say, particularly in solar energy, unparalleled in the history of the world. Germany, of course, did have a huge impetus to solar energy about a decade ago, or 7 or 8 years ago. But the scale at which India is planning its solar rollout of 100 gigs in the next, now 6.5 years left, demonstrating the commitment that this government has, that the people of India have towards a better planet to live in, our own consciousness, our own responsibility towards a clean planet, towards climate change, towards addressing the problems of greenhouse gases and emissions. The thrust on energy efficiency, where a single program of the government of India to replace every bulb throughout the length and breadth of India with an LED bulb in the next, now again, 2.5 years left, 6 months having already gone by, so as to save 100 billion units of electricity consumption a year. And mind you, 100 billion units only on replacing LED bulbs is no small measure, translating to a saving of nearly $6 billion of electricity bills for the consumers of India annually. And finally, the thrust that we have on upgrading the infrastructure at the last mile, the sub-transmission and distribution infrastructure, where subsequent to our last interaction, the government has approved two major schemes, the Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana for rural India and the Integrated Power Development Scheme for urban India. both of which together is a further investment of about $22 billion to upgrade the last mile connectivity and provide energy access to the 50 million households who even today continue to be deprived of electricity. Now, the last year has seen all of these roll out in the highest degree of transparency. It's been an absolute effort to make energy more affordable, an effort to ensure that runaway increases in tariffs is not the way forward. Rather, energy has to reach the last man at affordable prices, for which the way forward is better efficiency, lower cost of generating power, ability to take power to the length and breadth of India as and when required, and therefore ensure that power tariffs remain low, power cost remains low. The huge effort to contribute as a responsible world citizen in the global effort to bring down greenhouse gas emissions, and mind you, for a developing country to commit 33% to 35% reduction in carbon intensity, or the amount of carbon emissions per capita per unit of GDP, is truly a huge target, particularly when we are at the cusp of our development cycle. And finally, to come out on the 5th of November, barely 11 days ago, with probably the most aggressive program in the history of India to turn around the distribution sector. The Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana, UDAY, which we rolled out on 5th of November. I don't know if any of you was there on 9th of November, on Monday, last Monday. Were you there? When I shared the entire details of UDAY with the investor community. It was possibly also webcast around the world. And I spent nearly, four and a half hours that evening in explaining how we are, in the next 3 or 4 years, going to completely transform India's electricity sector. Having largely resolved the coal problem, having brought gas-based plants back into production, now at a level of about 40 or 50% by and large, having brought transmission into shape, South India, which had the biggest problem of transmission and availability of power, has benefited by nearly 5,000 megawatts in the short span of the last 18 months. And going forward, I'm planning another 20,000 megawatt of additional transmission capacity going down to southern India. And what we do have as a national grid today will will truly become an integrated, seamless grid in the next 3 or 4 years as we rapidly invest. I believe about $50 billion is our investment target in the transmission side in the next 3 or 4 years. And each of these, mind you, is being monitored at the highest level. None of the programs or projects or promises or commitments that I make is one that is made and forgotten, or one that is made and let the people monitor or see what progress happens. It's monitored at the highest level. I have one or two persons in the room here who have worked closely with the power ministry. And I don't know, maybe over a cup of tea, Mr. Roy can share his own experiences. He comes from Larsen & Toubro, one of the giants in the capital goods space and in the infrastructure space in India. Every one of these projects is monitored at the highest level for its efficiency. I'll share one or two examples to tell you the way we monitor, because that's one of the biggest concerns most people have when I talk about UDE. That, yeah, we've heard it before, but how will this time be different from the past? And I'll just share one or two examples to tell you why it will be different from the past. And I'll share it with live examples. You asked me, or you mentioned, that the coal story has been a success. Certainly, there is no new person who is running Coal India Limited. They do have a new managing director since we last met, and that was one of the questions that came from the audience. So I think around December we appointed Sutirth Bhattacharya. And I think I mentioned from your platform that I genuinely believe that it's not the nature of ownership of a company which defines its success or failure. It's leadership and vision which will determine whether a company, whether in public sector or in private sector, is successful or fails. And Coal India is a true example amongst my other companies like NTPC or NHPC or Power Grid. But Coal India is a shining example of how ordinary people can give you extraordinary results. After all, it's the same 300 odd thousand people in Coal India who've been there for years and years. And with the aging age profile of Coal India, I can assure you most of these 300,000, or at least 80-85% of them, would have been there in the last 30 years. So it's the same company which routinely for years gave you 1%, 2%, occasionally 4% growth, which is today standing at 9% growth in the current year. Hopefully taking it up into double digit before the year ends. It's the same people. But what happened differently? The ability to dream, the ability to think that they can make a billion tons. Period. Well, if they fail to make a billion tons and they do 980 million tons, maybe CLSA may come up with a report like many of the mainline media does. CIL fails to meet targets. I'm happy with that. I don't mind. But I would rather have them aim for a billion tons than aim to do 650 million tons by 2020 and then come back and tell you, look, we've done 655 or 660 million tons. And then you give them a report. They exceed targets. That's not what I'm aiming for. I want them to think big. I want the teams to be empowered to imagine that they can do a billion tons. And that's exactly what they've done. And how did they do it differently? They sat down company by company, subsidiary by subsidiary. They sat down mine by mine. I didn't do anything. Those same people who've been working there for 30 years, today know exactly which mine in the whole country is going to help them achieve that billion tons. They had hundreds of mines in Coal India which had not even been worked upon. I'll share a small example of Western Coalfields Limited. It was one of the laggards amongst my subsidiaries. 6 years ago, Western Coalfields had produced 45.7 million tons. 6 years ago. Last 6 years, every year they fell. Probably before I became minister, they produced 38 or 39 million tons in the year 13-14. For the first time in 14-15, they marginally increased by 5-6% to 41 million tons. This year, I hope they'll go back to 45.7, which they had achieved in 2009. So which means a growth of about 10-11% this year. But, and this, ladies and gentlemen, is the defining feature of the entire government of India and of Prime Minister Modi. But while we are working on these shorter term objectives, get coal out in the market, make sure it's sufficiently available, get 10% growth, 11% growth in Coal India this year. The bigger focus and our priority is for the long haul, is for structural improvements. How are we going to do it differently so that the future is bright? And I'll share with you what Western Coalfields did. Western Coalfields looked up all the mines that they had which had not been mined for years. And they drew up a plan. And in, mind you, in that billion tons, Western Coalfield target until 5th of November, the same day I offered this Uday, the same day I unveiled Uday to the nation, I also unveiled a new plan for Western Coalfields in a program 1 hour before the cabinet meeting. Western Coalfields' target was set at 60 million tons out of 1 billion tons. So they sat down deciding how they will achieve that. And lo and behold, what did they find? They find that most of their mines had run down, had been mined out so much that out of the 39 or 41 million tons they did last year, nearly 28 or 27 million tons would become zero going forward because those mines would have been completely mined out. So forget 60 million tons, they would have actually fallen to 20 million tons. So they got down to seeing what they can do to whether any of the existing mines have ability to add production, got down to seeing which of the mines they can ramp, start open quickly and then ramp up quickly. And I'm delighted to tell you, the first report they shared with me was in March of 2015, I had gone to open two new mines. The first two that Western Coalfield opened after 10 years. In a decade, that company had not opened a single mine. March 2015, I had gone to open two mines. And they said, you're going to get a surprise, you're going to get a surprise. I didn't know what it was. And there are these young, 500 young boys and girls we have hired in Coal India who are our visionaries, who are helping us to, in Western Coalfields. All of Coal India, I've hired 6,000 bright youngsters who are helping craft this vision for the future. But they're helping. The vision is still coming from my 300,000 employees, and the effort is still driven by those 300,000 Coal Indians. But they unveiled that day to me a roadmap promising me a mine a month. They said, every month on the 25th, you can fly down to Nagpur and we'll take you to open a new mine. And they listed out 24 mines that day. Two that were opened by me, 22 more in the coming 22 months. And they said, we will open 24 mines going forward and we'll achieve our 60 million tons that you've set for us in a billion tons. I was delighted. I promise you, I was delighted. And they have been opening a mine a month. Eight mines had been opened until September. Two which I opened, six more subsequently. In October, they invited me for another program to open two more mines. They wanted to make sure that they meet their targets. So between 22nd of March or thereabouts when I had gone and they unveiled the 24 mines map to the October visit, I think it was 26th October. They have already opened 10 new mines. And on that day, they said, sir, we have another surprise for you. I said, what is it? They said, no, we will want to come and share it with you in Delhi. We need about 2 weeks more. So give us a date. And by coincidence, I had offered them 5th of November to come to Delhi and give me that surprise. It so happened that Uday was approved just an hour after that. But why I feel confident about Uday is because of these things. On the 5th in Hotel Ashoka, they unveiled a new map before me and said, sir, these 10 have been opened, 14 are on track, but now we've added 12 more and we are going to take it up to 100 million tons. WCL now, which was 60 and we were worried how that 60 will come in a billion tons, has now upped the ante, reset their target, their own target, and said we will be 100 million tons out of that billion. Whether it exceeds from a billion, that's for you to look out. But we are going to do 100, and they have now made 36 mine plant, 10 open, 26 more in the next 26 months. I wonder if they have some more surprises for me going forward. But that's what, once you empower your team to do, they can do for you. And that's what helped us finally close last year with an additional 32 million tons, which was more than the cumulative increase of the 4 years before that, from 10 to 14. This year we'll add another 50 million tons. And I hope you saw the reports of its quarterly performance 2 or 3 days back. We have not increased prices in the last almost 18 months that I've been there. The last price increase was probably 20, 22 months ago. I have not increased prices by a dime. And you have, 15, 16% growth in net profit for the last quarter. And it's purely volume driven, quality driven. In Uday, I don't know if you have shared Uday with your colleagues, but it's on my net. You can, that presentation which I made on the 9th of November, you can, I would urge all of you to read that. And we stand committed to everything written in the Uday scheme. After all, I've presented it to the world in a public platform, and I put it on my website because I want to be held accountable. I want you to monitor me for whatever I've promised. And by 2019-20, or 18-19 for that matter, I am confident that as against a business as usual scenario, with the implementation of Uday, closely monitored by us at the center, and with the support of all the states, which, by the way, is pan-India, the country will be saving nearly $30 billion annually from a business as usual scenario to the implementation of Uday scenario. That's the level of difference that we will make to the energy sector in the months and years to come. In fact, fifth we announced Uday, sixth and seventh, I had, again by coincidence, because you'll appreciate an All India Power Ministers Conference is decided months in advance. So 5th and 6th, I had a power minister's conference in Kochi, down south, where every state government warmly and heartily welcomed Uday. We may have to tweak it a little bit to suit each state's individual circumstances. And I've always held the view, there's no one-size-fits-all. There's always a scope where, two of us can sit and negotiate something better, right? To make it more sustainable, to make it a win-win for everybody. So I'm very, very confident on the back of success stories like what happened in WCL, success stories of what happened in our LED program. I've done this in many occasions, but since I'm meeting you for the first time after that, I'd like to share with you what we've done with the LED story in India. In the year 2013-14, India has an energy efficiency company, EESL, Energy Efficiency Services Limited. It's a Government of India company. It had a small $14 million share capital and would turn around. I think its top line was not even $100 million, I think. Probably less than $100 million annually. 100 is a hell of a lot. I don't think it did anywhere close to that. Probably did $20 billion or something turnover. I frankly didn't even know it reports to me till 3 or 4 months after I became a minister. Because I was inundated with so many other bigger problems that it's only when one day they had a cabinet note and they came to brief me. I said, what is this all about? I said, sir, this comes under you. That's the Bureau of Energy Efficiency. So around August or so, I got into understanding what the dam work is all about. And I found in the whole year 13-14, that company had distributed 600,000, 0.6 million LED bulbs across the country. And they were procuring them at about $4.50 a piece. $4.50 a piece, 600,000 LED bulbs. That was India's energy efficiency effort in 2013-14 through this company. I'm sure they were doing other things also. I said, it certainly cannot have any impact, meaningful impact, if you're going to work at this level. So we got down to understanding what is the potential. And then the potential that was brought before me was that India has 770 million incandescent and some of them CFL bulbs. And CFL, mind you, is extremely dangerous given the mercury content in that. But India was actually promoting CFL bulbs as an energy efficiency measure. We were subsidizing CFL bulbs, which of course I immediately stopped after I realized the harmful impact it has on the environment. And I would think in another 6 months to a year, CFL will be history in India. But when I looked at the whole story and I said, we need to go up to 770 million. And can you imagine what is the possible impact that would have on India? It would save 100 billion units of electricity, 100 billion kWh of electricity annually, translating to nearly $6 billion of saving for India's consumers every year. And to many of you who are very concerned about climate change, translating to 60 million tons of carbon dioxide emission reduction, a saving of 60 million tons of carbon dioxide emission every year. Now, once that came to the table before me, we immediately decided to ramp and scale up this program. And I said, we've got to do it in 3 years. On 5th of January 2015, Prime Minister Modi launched the Domestic Energy Efficiency Lighting Program, DELP. Just note down my website address, it's DELP. Delhi, England, London, Paris. DELP.in. Go onto that site and you will find that having launched it in January, we've started distributing these bulbs somewhere in April 2015. And almost on a daily basis, we are ramping it up. Today, we are giving out 300,000 LED bulbs every day. 300,000 LED bulbs every day are distributed across the length and breadth of India. Not 1 cent of subsidy. People are paying full value, albeit in installments. We charge them 11 cents, which are about 14 cents upfront, that's 10 Indian rupees. And the balance they pay over 8 or 9 months, 10 rupees a month, which is less than the saving in their electricity bill, by the way. And then they can continue to enjoy the benefit for years to come. And as we speak right now, and if any of you has Googled DELP.in, you would have found this. As we speak, 27 million bulbs have already gone out through the efforts without a single rupee subsidy. ESL has given out 27,089,917 LED bulbs. And I promise you, by 2019, India will be 100% LED. 770 bulbs. And many more for the growth, new buildings, new offices, new factories that will come up, will all be LED. And this is real-time data. It'll update itself in another 30 seconds as it's being distributed all across the country. And just by the way, that $4.50 that the government used to pay for a 7-watt LED bulb in the last 1 year has fallen to $1.10. I paid 24% of what was being paid before Prime Minister Modi took charge for a 9-watt LED bulb, 30% more capacity, absolutely no compromise on technical specs. I still buy from Philips, from Crompton Greaves, the best Cisco, from the best of companies in the world. As an aside, at Davos, the world CEO of Philips was at one of the luncheons with me where we were discussing energy efficiency. And in the course of our conversation, since it was just soon after we had launched on 5th of January at the hands of the Prime Minister, Davos was in the third week of January or so, just before our Republic Day. So it was 23rd or 24th of January. And I was sharing with him these plans, which I'm sharing with you. And we had a very lovely conversation. Matter ended there. Came and met me a month ago. And I thought he must be wanting to discuss some business problem, or everybody comes with problems. Nobody comes with any good news here. So I thought it's some problems. We'll see what is this problem. We'll sort it out. And he came, he met me. We exchanged pleasantries. He said, I have no work with you. I've just come to acknowledge that I had completely disbelieved everything you told me at that lunch at Davos. But I've only come to acknowledge that today I'm convinced you'll make it happen. And with that same commitment, since you told me that you're wanting to know what will happen, I can promise you Uday, the Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana, will be implemented with the support of every state, with everybody in the entire value chain of the power sector. It will be a game changer. It'll sort out not only the power sector, it'll sort out my desire to ensure affordable energy access to everybody in the length and breadth of the country, but it'll also sort out our future plans to have a strong and vibrant banking sector. It'll encourage more industry and manufacturing to come to India. Obviously, nobody goes and sets up plants in an energy-starved nation. You want to go and do progress, set up investments in a country where you can get energy on like a tap, water in a tap. That's what we are now working on. 15-day commitment that you want power, you get power, 15 days, anywhere in the country. That's the commitment I've asked all the states to take upon themselves, and we are working closely to achieve that. I started with attempting 1 day, but then I backtracked because I found that whiplash was too much on me. So we settled at 15 days to begin with, but I'll better that as we go forward. By the way, the number has changed. It's 27,092,637. So in the last 1 minute or so, 1,700 odd more bulbs have gone out. So I've only tried to give you these examples to commit to you that we shall make Uday a success. We shall have energy access to everybody in the country. We shall have affordable energy access. And to my mind, all these structural changes that the entire government of India as a team, all of us in different ministries together, have focused our energies on, have prioritized over the last 18 months, will result in a significant upswing in the Indian economy going forward. I remember while we were celebrating Diwali during last week, I was sharing with some friends, of course that was off the record, possibly today I'm speaking on record, that I see 6 months from now a huge upswing in the Indian economy, something which India would never have seen before, an unparalleled growth trajectory going forward. And to my mind, next year will be the inflection point where Indian economy is going to take off from there. And I can assure you the power sector will not be found wanting or lacking. We'll be right there in the thick of things, in the forefront of the changed economy that I see India going into. We clearly are the largest, fastest growing large economy in the world today. But going forward, I see this economy reaching scintillating heights in the years ahead, starting from the year 2016-17. Thank you.
Great overview. Also, thanks for sharing all the little anecdotes. I think those go a long way in sort of giving this assurance. Just one small point, you know, on CLSA research, let me just assure you that, you know, we adhere to the highest standards of quality. And, you know, and you know, just recently, in fact, you know, we sort of, you know, organized a few investor trips, you know, into the Naxal hit areas of, you know, Jharkhand and Odisha to highlight the kind of, you know, real work happening on the ground. I doubt if any of our competition would have gone to this kind of level. So let me just assure you on that. Okay. So, you know, we already have, you know, a question.
I think it was a report which expressed an opinion of your analyst, possibly. So I'm not commenting on probably the quality of your statistics or the data that you brought out, but it was an opinion expressed and it was right. It's your report only. I've just used Mr. Google to verify it. So it was an opinion expressed by your company.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
My name is TJ Boy. I work for Sands Capital Management.
Yeah, we're not. It's not audible. Yeah, please. Yeah, now you can.
I have some few questions regarding the power sector. I'm just
hold the mic to your mouth. You know.
Can you hear me now?
Now.
Okay. I have some few questions on the power sector. The first is just the, you know, the contrasting objectives of having a low power tariff and also having an economically viable state electricity boards.
Can you put that to your,
The objectives of ensuring the power tariffs are low, but I am also trying to make sure that state electricity boards who distribute the electricity are in a viable financial situation. How do you address that? The second question is, on the production of coal. Currently India imports a lot of coal. I just wanted to get a sense of where you think, what's the potential for domestic coal to completely substitute imported coal. Specifically, can you address the issue of the quality of the coal? There are some that do say the quality of the coal, because some people say you would need a certain quantity of imports to mix with domestic coal. And the final question I have is on solar. To what extent do you think solar can be a source of baseload power in India? Because some people have said it can be a complementary source to you know, to coal and other power source, but it's unlikely to be a baseload power source. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Mr. Goyal wants to take all the questions up front and, you know, then he'll probably address
I'm
all of...
I'm making notes, so I'll answer all those.
Yeah.
That's regarding solar. How do you finance that? Do you have a concrete plan? Because it's a lovely vision, but if it only stays beautiful, it doesn't really work, does it?
So that's the advantage. I can combine.
Okay, sure. Okay, this.
My question was if you can elaborate on your prediction that in 6 months' time the economy will pick up. What is your basis for that view?
Well, I'm not in consulting anymore, so this is just my personal opinion.
Sir, also if you could highlight what you said on 9th, that why your Uday plan will not fail while earlier two plans did. If you could just repeat for the interest of this group, that will be helpful, sir.
Thank you, gentlemen. Very, very interesting questions you've raised. In fact, that's exactly what UDAY, Ujjwal Discom Assurance Yojana, tries to address. I've often, on many occasions, articulated a small example to explain what UDAY is all about. Suppose Mahesh makes bottled water, and I make bottled water, right? Mahesh does it efficiently, doesn't waste too much water as he processes, he does the RO process, uses his plastic efficiently, buys his caps honestly, doesn't skim money from his company, uses labor efficiently, and he sells it for maybe a dollar. But I'm an inefficient fellow. I waste a lot of water. I take out 5-10% of the company's money and put it into my personal account. I'm corrupt. I'm inefficient. I employ 30% more labor than what Mahesh does. I waste plastic so that against a 1% acceptable waste, mine is 6%. Can I come to you and say, hey guys, you know, I'm inefficient, but please pay me $1.20 because otherwise I won't make a profit and I won't survive. Would any of you in the room be willing to pay that? I would suspect no, unless you're willing to do that. Inefficiencies in the system cannot be passed on to the consumer through tariff hikes. This so-called reform, and that I always get very amused when all the research analysts come up with these fancy reports that India needs to increase its power tariffs. India needs to rewrite its tariff book. Well, you produce efficiently, generate efficiently, transmit efficiently, distribute efficiently, and the consumer is willing to pay you a fair tariff. And that's the job of the regulator. He sets the tariff. I don't set the tariff. State doesn't set the tariff. Investors and analysts cannot tell us to order them to set the tariff also. I would go to jail if I was to order the regulator to increase the tariffs. It's the regulator's job to ask consumers to pay what is fair and correct. They cannot allow the inefficiency to be passed on to the consumer. And what I have determined through UDAY is more and more avenues by which a large part of this so-called DISCOM loss is because of inefficiencies. And if we can plug those inefficiencies, then whatever is the residual tariff increase required would be so small or possibly inconsequential that in the routine course, as the regulator sets tariff, and now we are giving them the ability to set it every quarter, so they can have an annual tariff determination, which will revise tariffs every quarter, the stress on the system is more calibrated, is more gradual. But just indiscriminately increasing tariffs is a license for further inefficiency. Which means I can be further inefficient if my consumer is now willing to pay me $1.20 for that water bottle. And I know that it's a pass-through. Tomorrow, if I'm more corrupt or I'm more inefficient, I can even get $1.30 for that same bottle. So I'll have to be efficient. I'll have to set my house in order. And then whatever is the fair tariff, consumer will pay for that. That's the approach of UDAY. And I've defined it. If you go to my website or my ministry website, it's a 70-slide detailed presentation. You can Google UDAY, UDAY presentation, and you'll get that presentation on. And I've detailed exactly what we are going to do. No false promises, no utopian promises. It's a very well chalked out program that's before you. And you hold me accountable. Somebody asked, why will UDAY not fail? UDAY will not fail because of two primary reasons. One, it's a carrot and stick approach. I'm incentivizing all the states to come and join up, sign up with UDAY, enter into an agreement with me on deliverables. What I have to do to help them, what the state government will do, what the DISCOMs will do. We are creating an iron-tight agreement where all three of us will be accountable to performance parameters, KPAs and KPIs. And for all those who are doing well, I'm not promising them grants or money or anything. I'm promising them more coal, which can make their power cheaper. I'm promising them support through these schemes, which can help them upgrade their infrastructure, serve their people better, possibly win the next election again. So the entire effort is handholding and supporting each other to achieve an end objective together. It's not a top-down approach. The entire Uday scheme has been a bottom-up approach. I've personally had meetings from chief ministers of states down to engineers working in DISCOMs to figure out what's going wrong, what needs to be done better. That's one part of it. And second, there's a hard budget constraint at the end of the day. So if they do make any further loss, the state will have to foot the bill. No bank is going to lend them money anymore to fund the losses. In the past, every restructuring provided for banks to fund the losses. I said you are free to make losses. You can do what you like with your discount, be inefficient. Give a state government guaranteed bond and raise the money. Neither will the central government give you money, nor will the banking system give you money. State government can raise whatever money they want, and for which India already has a very well-defined restriction and fiscal responsibility and budget management targets for each state. So unless the central government and the Reserve Bank permit, states cannot issue bonds. So there's a hard budget constraint to incentivize states to get back into good shape, get their DISCOMs into good shape. Well, domestic coal, we are ramping up rapidly, and we are also setting right the quality problems. So in 2 years, we are setting up 250 million tons of washeries. I think L&T is hearing that and planning their future plans to scale up washery manufacturing. But you know how washeries used to be set up in the past? It used to take 6 years. Every mine had a new design. Based on new design, a new tender, an RFP, an environmental clearance and whatnot. I'm working on a common design. I'm standardizing washeries. Getting Environment Ministry to approve it one time and ordering with economies of scale. Just like LEDs came down from $450 to $110, $1.10, 24% in 1 year. Reduction of 76% in 1 year. I hope my suppliers of washeries, and I hope you're hearing this loud and clear, will bring down their prices to also significantly lower levels. So we're going to wash the coal. I'm committing that by 1st April, every piece of coal will be crushed to 100 mm and supplied, so no more boulders. And I've got the coal controller reassessing all the mines to give the honest GCV grading of the mine. Probably at the next stage, I may even correct the pricing structure because the pricing today is like a hockey stick. Some of the prices are too low. The good grades are very high priced, so many people don't pick up those grades and therefore choose to import. Your question about imports. I'm right sizing and trying to align the prices based on GCV. Then the long distance guys, and I'm sure you'll appreciate, somebody who's got to transmit coal 2,000 kilometers would like to then buy a higher grade coal, his freight costs remaining constant. And if there's a linearity to the GCV value and pricing, you'll obviously prefer to buy the higher grades. Coastal plants today find import cheaper, considering domestic coal's problems of freight transportation over long distances. Till that time, they may import some quantities. But in the long run, I don't see imports as any viable option. Solar will certainly be a source of power. I don't know if Mahesh remembers, I had said solar will be sub 5 rupees. Just like I said, LEDs should be 99 rupees. Everybody had laughed when I said 99, it's 72. People had laughed when I had said solar will be sub 5 rupees. I have done nothing. I have not given any grant, any subsidy, nothing at all. The last price discovered through honest and competitive procurement. through a reverse bidding process was 4 rupees 63 paisa. So in dollars, it would be about four and a half or five cents per unit of solar power, which is nearly grid parity. I was at a KPMG event just before I came here, and they had predicted in 17 we'll be reaching grid parity. We've reached that in 2015. What did I do? Economies of scale. I've promised a large volume, which I'm actually bidding out now. Honesty, it's a transparent bidding process to procure it. Better payment terms, so I've addressed the issues of counterparty risk, introducing companies like NTPC and SECI. And by the time I'll have the DISCOMs in shape, then NTPC need not be in the play, then the DISCOMs themselves can procure. So it's a composite effort, working in different, you know, plugging the holes in different dimensions. Just like you as an investment banker would like to see. Lesser counterparty risk, lower interest rates, more efficient procurement so that there's transparency. And promise that person who comes in this field can plan to scale up. So I asked somebody who bid very aggressively in an earlier tender. He said, well, I've contracted 5 gigawatts. I know you're going to scale it up so much. I've contracted 5 gigawatts. I've got a damn good deal on my CapEx. Therefore, I was able to offer some 5 rupees 5 paisa earlier, which has now come to 463. Now, this may vary in each state because of radiation. The irradiance in each state may vary, and all that's all operational pricing will differ location to location. But we've set a benchmark. And as regards financing, once the DISCOM issue is sorted out, my government financial institutions like REC, PFC alone will have $20 billion to lend, which will largely go for transmission, renewable energy, the new sectors where I need more money. I've been going around the world. There are more than enough people in the private sector who are willing to finance renewable energy. Very soon, we'll be coming out with some announcements on a quasi-sovereign fund. And I'll be coming out with an RFP to select who will manage that fund. So we'll look for the best in the world to come and manage that fund. I don't think finance from the private sector will be a problem. My angst, of course, is that the governments of the West, of Europe and the United States, who are responsible for the mess we are in the first place, are doing nothing to really solve the problem of the world. Be it in energy efficiency, be it in their living pattern, be it in the way they are wasting the consumption-led lifestyles that are there in the West, be it in the fact that 2 o'clock midnight, if you open the, draw the curtains of your hotel room in New York, you may find a 100-story building with not a single person, not a single office working, with lights on top to bottom. Maybe I should show you that. With this kind of consumerism and this kind of complete disrespect for the environment, I think we have an interesting COP21 coming up in Paris, where a lot of questions will be asked about climate justice and the role of the polluters in trying to, this is right outside my hotel room in New York last month, less than 30 days ago. A whole office building, top to bottom, this is after office hours. All lights on, full light. So I think India is doing a hell of a lot for promoting renewable energy, efficiency, addressing concerns of climate change. I wish the West would show an equal amount of responsibility to the world. I think that's the question. Somebody asked me about why 6 months the economy will change. Because it's on the back of the structural improvements that we've done in the 18 months. After all, where did we spend most of our energies and what did we prioritize? We prioritized in cleaning up the system, bringing the highest levels of honesty, integrity, probity. We brought a system which is corruption-free to the country. We focused our efforts on an enabling framework on the back of which the economy can roll. A framework where power can be available for all 24/7. A framework of how affordable housing will be rolled out. The road sector, which we had inherited in a mess, I don't know if you're talking to Mr. Gadkari. I think the star performer of this government is the road sector, the highway sector. He inherited such a big, colossal mess, which he has untangled in the last 18 months. And now you'll see all of that rolling out in terms of jobs, in terms of demand for steel, cement, in terms of infrastructure equipment, in terms of contracting companies getting business. But untangling the damn mess was not an easy task. So it's on the strength of our 18 months relentless pursuit of structural improvements, setting the framework right, that I say with confidence that the economy is set to roll. Thank you.
Okay, just one last question. Just wanted to share some experiences on the coal, power in sense of distribution, generation, as well as execution, renewable energy. And I just wanted to explain to the audience, he is available totally at any point in time, is my experience, and that is one part of it. And all the projects when he took over of mine in power sector were stranded because of environmental reasons or funding or something. And I went to him, and after that, once if I had gone to him, next time it was on a telephonic conversation, I never had to take an appointment from him. However, I had to give something in return. So that is very important, which I wanted to share. The job was done, and all the clearances were there. But in the bargain, the Honorable Minister also said that how fast now you can complete. He was talking on the coal washeries job. Say, contractually, I was required to complete in 1 year time. And he says, no, now all these things, I want to hasten the process, contractually, all right, but how fast you could do it, and we completed in 9 months. So that was the pressure under which we work when we go there, as well as it's very positive, and I think whatever he said, he means it, but one has to be a little careful on the timelines, please. Thank you.
You will have to be faster than what I said.
Yeah.
So we completely run out of time here, gentlemen. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Goyal for his very inspirational speech. Thank you.
Thank you.